You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good morning. Welcome to Health in Public Education. I'm Robin Sinks, and today is our 11th session in our course, and we are going to continue our discussion on injury prevention and safety. This is the fifth of six of our content areas. I'm glad you are here with me. I hope that you will join in the conversation. You can certainly give me a call. The number is there on your screen. And if you don't want to give me a call, you can certainly email in your comments, questions to the email address that is now on your screen. So I certainly hope that you will participate in the discussion today as we continue looking at this particular content area. Remember last week we were talking more about the unintentional injuries, what a lot of folks refer to as accident prevention, and we really looked at it more from a perspective of not it's an accident waiting to happen, but what can we do to either prevent the incident, prevent injury from the incident, or prevent disability from any injuries. So anyway, I have to tell you, I was thinking about you all last night and this morning as we felt a little rumbler of an earthquake, and some of you maybe more than others. And I hope that if the discussion last week, there we go, if that discussion didn't get you thinking about preparedness, and I know the earthquake discussion was just a little part of it, but certainly I hope that what's been happening in the LA Basin for the last 10, 12 days might spur you to that, particularly after last night. So go back and read that section, take a look at some of the resources, and be prepared yourself. It's a great way to think about how what we talk about here, health in public education, has implications for all of us personally as well. So we'll hope that it's a calm morning and we can talk about some of the other issues in this content. Particularly what we're going to do today is focus on the intentional injuries. And this is the violence end of the spectrum. So what I'd like you to do as you're sitting there after having read the textbook, looked at some of the documents that I have posted on Blackboard for you, I'd like you to just think about how does violence affect children? Think about what students, what our kids need to be to know. What do our students need to be able to do in this whole side of injury prevention and safety? So how does violence affect our children? So as you think about those questions, feel free to make your comments, give me a call. I would like to hear what you're seeing and what you're concerned about as we kind of go through some of the topics. So we'll intersperse those with what I have to share with you this morning. So let's talk just a little bit about intentional injuries, or what we call violence. Basically, what we are referring to are all of the behaviors that intentionally threaten, attempt to, or inflict harm on others. So there is a purposeful intent here, and there is the resulting harm. And that harm can be physical, certainly, but we're also talking about the fear associated with acts of violence. Those fears often can infringe on our feelings of personal freedom. They infringe on our need to be safe. And so certainly have an impact not only on students in schools, but on their families and on the community at large. And several years back, the Surgeon General declared that violence and risk reduction around issues of violence was a public health priority for the United States. So typically, you know, we think about public health priorities being those that are related to physical health. And certainly there is a physical health component here, but we're really talking about if that was an identification of something that really had gone beyond the traditional belief of health behaviors. So we certainly do consider violence prevention part of health education, part of what we do in schools to help students know and be able to do. So we want to make sure that when we start addressing this in classroom, when conversations come up, that we support our students. We help them deal with not only the fears, but any direct impact of that violence. We certainly know that even the exposure to violence or violent activities activates this threat response within each of us. And in children, that developing brain, that threat response activation really does make an impact on how they think and how they view the world. Very often what we encounter is children who have been exposed to violence, either directly or indirectly through the news media, through entertainment, they're really kind of on guard all the time. And their brain is in that heightened sensitivity. And often because of that, they're not able to focus on what we want them to do in schools. We certainly know that research has confirmed that the impact in schools is significant. We see attendance problems. We see behavior problems, many resulting in suspension, failing grades, performing below grade level, limited concentration and attention span. So we do know that even if the violence is not occurring in schools, the exposure to that in families, in their communities, through the media, certainly affects what happens in schools. So let's take a few comments. I see a lot of them are coming in. I'm trying to ignore the screen down here and I just see it rolling. So let's go back up and good morning to Alexandra. I'm glad you're with us this morning. Okay, let's see what you've got. Right from the beginning, I found some statistics. Okay, good. So in the textbook, Alexandra is highlighting just a few of them. Every 19 seconds, a child is arrested. Every 20 seconds, a public school student is corporally punished. That's a spanking. Every 41 seconds, a child is confirmed as abused or neglected. Every 7 minutes, a child is arrested for committing a violent crime. Every 3 hours, a child or a teen is killed by a firearm. Every 5 hours, a child or teen commits suicide. And every 6 hours, a child is killed as a result of abuse or neglect. And so Alexandra goes on to share that she couldn't help but think about how this could have been prevented with children and teens, because really we don't want it to get to this point. And wholeheartedly, you know, I agree, Alexandra. Those are some pretty shocking statistics. And we have seen that over time. And really, there are things that we can do, and we'll talk a little bit about those today. But I think we all just have to be very aware of our students, of the children that we work with, the neighborhoods they live in, the families and the communities that they come from, and be very sensitive to those issues. Anthony is also here with us this morning. Good morning. Anthony's sharing that he believes that if children are exposed to violence, that they believe that the acts they see are normal and acceptable. Absolutely. We're talking about that social norming issue. And I think that's where we certainly have a role to play in saying this is not normal behavior. But yet we live in a society that where we talk about violence prevention an awful lot, but we see it in all that we do and portrayed and glamorized very often. We talked a little bit about that last week, just with risk-taking behaviors. Even what individuals do that is very protective, law enforcement, the firefighters, etc., the risk involved in that is very glamorized. Certainly we see violence very glamorized, and we need to remind kids that that's not the normal way of behavior, particularly those media images. Because very often kids associate the media with reality, and we know that that's certainly not true. Rhonda Sue is with us. Good morning, Rhonda Sue. Violence doesn't just affect children physically, but also emotionally as children lose their sense of safety. Absolutely. Some of our children may never experience the physical effects of violence, but certainly mentally that takes a toll on them and really puts them on guard. And as I said, that keeps them distracted from what we hope that they will do in schools and what they need to learn. Kiana is also with us. You guys are up early this morning. Exposure to violence can cause children to develop unrealistic or inappropriate conflict resolution skills. Students need to know that there are alternative solutions to their problems, and violence will often exacerbate the problem rather than fix it. Good point. I do think that very often we are quick to respond with words with actions. And that whole issue of self-control is one that we need to teach and support in children and really working with them, and not just with conflict resolution. We're going to talk a little bit about that later. But in preventing, sometimes we can prevent the conflict before it arises. Sometimes conflict is just there, so we need to know how to deal with it appropriately. Okay, let's see. I'm in between two here. Okay, Tashia. Violence affects children in negative ways because it harms them emotionally and physically. Brings about fear, which makes them feel less comfortable at home, at school, and in the community. Watching TV, video games, certainly you're picking up on some of the same things that we've kind of talked about some this morning. It also affects a child's ability to function well at school. Again, reinforcing that children need to know violence doesn't solve problems, and to start to talk to children when they are young about this. Keeping hands to selves, avoiding the hitting, the kicking, the hurtful words, all of those types of things. I think you've all got the gist of this. I mean, there are significant impacts of violence on health and on academic performance. So let's go on now, and we'll talk about some of the issues that were addressed in the text. I'm not going to go through all of them, but I do want to identify just a few of them. And I see the screen moving. Okay, all right, we're good. I am going to skip the section in your text about violence in the world and trauma. If you will remember back to when Nancy Jefferson was here, we were talking about mental health and mental, emotional, and social health. We talked a little bit about the trauma that children experience in their families, in their communities, through the media, and that effect on them. And I think this is a good review of some of the points that she shared. I'm also not going to address today violence in the school setting. You know, school is a very safe place for children. And on almost every survey done, we know that students report that they feel safer at school than at home or and in their community. I don't just mean home, but the community at large. There are certainly issues that happen at school, and we're going to address a couple of those here. But I do think that very often violence in schools is really exacerbated through the media. It's really highlighted to the sense that, again, it's changing folks' perspectives where they think this happens all the time in schools. Schools are really very generally a safe place. So let's go into the section that we're looking at violence in the home, and then we will be looking at violence that can happen in the community, in schools, and in the home. So I want to start out with some information on child abuse. And I'm sure those of you who are clearing your credential have heard a fair amount about child abuse and about reporting your suspicions of. So some of this may be a review for some of you. To some, this may be new. So I want to make sure that we hit some of the key points here. When we are talking about child abuse, we are talking about basically four types of behavior. The first is physical abuse, and this is very often what we assume first off when we hear that term, child abuse. Physical abuse is non-accidental injury to a child. It typically results in some type of physical injury. From bruises to burns to broken bones, and in extreme cases, up to and including death. When we are talking about physical abuse, we are talking about someone who is out of control with their own issues, taking it out on that child. The second type of abuse that we all need to be very aware of is neglect. And neglect is when a caretaker, a caregiver, fails to provide basic necessities. We're talking about food, shelter, medical care, just a safe emotional environment, safety issues, even providing for educational. When we're talking about neglect, these are much harder kinds of issues to pinpoint. And though they may not leave the bumps and the bruises, certainly the impact is significant and long-term. And so sometimes as individuals who are working with students, it's a lot harder to pinpoint an incident of neglect, but what we're looking at are behaviors over time. Another type of abuse is the emotional abuse. Emotional abuse are those behaviors that harm a child's self-worth or emotional well-being. This is name-calling, shaming, rejection, withholding of affection, threatening acts without the physical component. And again, this is a tough one because, again, we may not see the physical indicators of the bumps and the bruises, but again, very significant impact. And often a little harder to report our suspicions of because we have to look at maybe a little bit longer period of time with all of that. The last or the fourth type of abuse that we want to talk about is sexual abuse. And these sexual abuse can involve not only physical acts, but photographing children, exposing children to sexual activity and pornography. We certainly know that when we are looking at those four types of abuse, research has confirmed that children who are maltreated have a distorted view of their world, very similar to, you know, children exposed to other types of violence. The effects of child abuse certainly influence a child's ability to interact with others, to make friends, to build close, positive relationships, and that stress early on certainly does impact their mental, emotional development, so really does impact how the brain works. And when you have those impacts on the brain, you have the negative impacts on the ability to achieve academically. Typically, whenever we're working with children who are exposed to child abuse, either in the family, maybe directed toward another family member, or a recipient of those behaviors, we are looking at behaviors where that child is extremely cautious, probably withdrawn, possibly delayed in language development, that sense of powerlessness. They may not be able to set goals. They're very much in the here and now, the short-term survival mode. And certainly, those are not the only behaviors. We can certainly see the other extreme, that those children who are impacted by child abuse may also exhibit those violent behaviors toward others. So may not be withdrawn, but may be very aggressive. We do know that child abuse is more likely to occur in families and communities during times of stress, whether that's economic, substance abuse, other family relationships. We know that child abuse happens across the board. All socioeconomic levels, all cultures, races, ethnicities. And we need to remember that it is never the fault of a child. That it certainly is not anything that they have control over. And no matter how children behave, they are not to be treated that way. And we also know, just very similarly to the substance abuse in families, that many children in the in abusive families are taught not to talk about the abuse with anyone else. So that sense of secrecy. Okay, so we certainly know that it does impact families. It does impact communities, and it impacts our classrooms. So let's go to some more of the comments. I see they are being fast and furiously put up. And let's just go back. Remember, our question was, how does violence affect children? So again, we left it pretty open and broad. Laura is with us and sharing that she's heard quite a few parents admit that they've told their children to hit back if someone hits them. Laura's sharing how she feels that makes it so difficult to teach kids that violence won't solve problems. Certainly, I too have heard those same comments. I probably heard those even in my own family growing up. I think that's kind of a very quick response. I think that's part of our societal norm to take care of yourself, to stand up for yourself, but certainly engaging back in the violent behavior is not going to solve the issue of the violence, but it just escalates those behaviors. And then much more, it becomes not an issue of one individual imparting violence to another, but now you've got more people involved, so consequences spread out over many. Mitch is with us this morning and sharing that it might be a value judgment, but so much of the violence may start at home. And if it's seen as unacceptable by parents and older siblings, can be reinforced readily as violence or physical resolution of a conflict. This includes access to media. There may not be a direct line of correlation between the violence seen in all forms of media, but certainly a child's imagination is expanded to include violent solutions to personal problems. Absolutely, I think it's a restatement of what some of you have said, is that, you know, if students are hearing that violence is okay at home, it is hard to teach that violence is not okay when we're in school and in our community organizations. And we certainly know that if we can all align with similar messages, those messages gain strength. So I think that provides another opportunity for us to work with parents of children. I know we're talking about, you know, health issues in public education, and most of us think about only working with our students. But I do want you to think about the fact that we need to work with our families as well, sharing with them what we are teaching their children, encouraging homework components where children go and share what they've learned in class with their families, so that we can maybe align a little bit more strongly. Great opportunities for parent meetings at school sites. Very often when violence occurs, you know, we have a parent meeting at a school site, and we talk about what we're doing in schools, and what we really should expand those meetings to is, what are we doing in communities? What are we doing in homes, in neighborhoods, in all of the community organizations that are involved? Okay, a lot of you are commenting about violence in the media. Vanessa's sharing a comment that, again, she's seeing students definitely affected with violence through the media. So children see it as normal. We're talking about those social norms. So we really are looking at trying to change social norms. We certainly have changed social norms around tobacco use in this country. We need to change it around violence. Again, we talk a lot about the media, and I think that, going back to my earlier conversation about working with parents, is it's okay to limit our students' time with media. Many of our children watch hours and hours of television. They are on the computer. They are video gaming. They are listening to music. And much of that portrays violence as normal. I think sometimes we need to say to parents, it's okay to limit that exposure. And that's an important thing that we can do in families, for ourselves and for our students. Okay, let's go to the next comment. Ashley is also with us this morning. Thank you guys so much for being with me today and sharing your thoughts. Ashley's sharing that, you know, again, violence is one of those issues that affects a child as a whole. So physical, mental, spiritually, cognitively, lowering self-esteem, self-confidence, and attachment. I think you are all very, very aligned to what the authors of the text are saying and what your own experiences are confirming. And also sharing that physical and sexual abuse is also cyclical. And I guess I would say even beyond physical and sexual abuse, but violence in general, it can be very cyclical. Oftentimes we think, well, if that happens to a child, the child won't engage in that behavior later on, but we see that so many of those behaviors are learned so early and entrenched so deeply. Lisa is also with us, sharing that she experienced a small group of first grade students where one punched another in the face and the other chanted, fight, fight, fight. So certainly that bystander effect. And thank you for sharing, Lisa. That experience is one that has been around forever and ever. And I think that those are times that we need to be really listening to all of the students, not just dealing with those involved in the incident, but the bystanders. And we'll actually talk a little bit about that in just a few minutes. So that rather than encouraging the violent behavior, rather than giving the instigator, the aggressor, confidence and notice and attention, we actually need to teach our bystanders to give support to the individual who is being hurt, and getting kids to start to stand up to those who are being violent. You know, media has an amazing amount of power in our culture. We have a question up, you know, do kids need to be watching Ultimate Fighting? Because then we see them doing that on campus, outside on the playground. And again, I think it's really important that we share with our families the impact of just watching some of these things and helping students get a better sense of what is reality versus what is in the media, and that exposure to even things like Ultimate Fighting really don't have a place on a playground. They don't have a place in school. That yes, there are individuals who are involved in this, who train, who do all of this, and it's not a free-for-all. But I mean, the question this time is Ultimate Fighting. Years past, it was boxing, it's wrestling. There's always some type of aggressive sport, and I'm going to put sport in quotes, whether or not that's good for our kids to see. And I think it sends a negative message. So, okay, I'm not seeing any more comments. So I'm going to go back over here to my outline for the morning. And let's go back. I want you to think back to what we were talking about with specifically child abuse as our example of violence. And I've shared some things that we need to talk with parents about. I want to share specifically what we can work with our students about and around in this issue of child abuse. I think it's really very important that students need to be, there need to be classroom discussions about child abuse in schools, from preschool on up. And I think a very easy way to start those conversations is around the concept of touches. That there are safe, unsafe, and secret touches. And what can we all do when someone touches us in that way? I think we have to recognize that touch is important for human beings. That those safe touches are those that make us feel warm, they make us feel appreciated, they make us feel loved, they make us feel safe. And those kind of touches, you know, making us feel good, are good. They are appropriate. There are unsafe touches that make us feel uncomfortable. They may hurt. They may feel confusing. A lot of our kids say, I don't know what that was. Some of our kids will talk about it as yucky touches. But basically, when someone touches us in a way that makes us feel unsafe, what do we do? So we have to identify these types of touches for our students. We also need to talk about secret touches, because very often adults will touch a child and then say, keep it a secret, don't talk about it. This is our secret. And students should know that, so that when they hear that phrase, they say, oh, wait, there's something awry here. I mean, there are good secrets. You know, the surprise birthday party, the gift that you want to give to a special friend or family member. Those are okay secrets. But secrets about something, some kind of touching, whether it is a sexual touch, touching parts of your body that you don't want other people to touch, whether it's an unsafe touch, a hurtful touch, that whenever someone asks us to keep those kinds of things a secret, we need to have that reaction. We need to be caught aware of that. And when individuals are touching us in an unsafe or secret manner, we need to know what to do. And a very simple way to teach kids that is no go tell. Children need to be taught how to assert their personal space, and that they can tell an adult, no, please don't touch me like that. And sometimes that no needs to be much more forceful. And we practice with students, saying, no, don't touch me like that. So if a please don't touch me like that doesn't work, then we go on and we keep talking about that. Very often we tell our students, that they don't have a choice, that they have to do everything we tell them to. And we need to give them power to a little bit of power back and say, no, if somebody touches you in a way that you don't want them to be touched, it's okay to say no. Even if that's your grandma giving you that big, wet, slobbery kiss, if you don't like that, just say, Grandma, I really wish you wouldn't do that. Can we just have a big hug? And so teaching those communication skills, helping students know that they can express their feelings, their likes, their wishes. We certainly also need to be able to teach our students how to go or get away from an unsafe situation. We need to keep in mind, depending on the age of the child, how we teach them to go, because we certainly don't want them to go from one unsafe situation into another unsafe situation. We don't want them to run away. We don't want them to run out into the street we don't want them to be unsafe. So we need to strategize, where would you go if you didn't feel safe? And then the last part of that is tell. Who could you tell about that unsafe touch, that secret touch, that feeling that you had when someone did something to you? And they need to identify individuals not only at school, but in their family, in their neighborhood. And we need to remember that all of this is really key to teaching skills to students that they're going to use in their lifetime for a variety of issues. I do need to remind you all that when you have any suspicion of child abuse in any format, you are mandated to report those suspicions. So I just want to remind you about the mandated reporting laws. It is not a teacher's responsibility to investigate or determine the identity of a perpetrator or, gather information about the incident itself. The job of the teachers and other mandated reporters is just to report suspicion. I think something might be happening. The child said this to me. It's really a request to have someone from law enforcement, from Child Protective Services, go out and do the investigating. Teachers are not investigators. Mandated reporters are immune from legal action in almost every state in the country. And you, as a mandated reporter, certainly want to make a record of any reports that you make, because sometimes that first report may not be the attention grabber, but you may see it happen again, you report again. You may see something again, you report again. So I just want to make sure that up on the screen we have the website for mandated reporting in LA County. So take note of that particular website. It will literally walk you through what you need to do, because there is a telephone number there. And I think we have that up on the screen now. You call that in as soon as you can, once you have that suspicion of abuse, and then you must follow up with the online report within 36 clock hours. I'm going to repeat that, 36 clock hours. Because what happens is if on a Friday afternoon, a child says something to you, your suspicions are raised, and you decide you need to make that report, you have to get that report in, the online report, over the weekend. If you wait until you come back to school on Monday, you have exceeded the timeline and possibly could be held liable for that. Okay, I want to go to a quick video clip on dealing with disclosures of abuse. It's a real hard thing to hear when a child shares with you the details of some type of abuse. So, from the mouths of children, here's what we should do when dealing with disclosures.
Talk to me so I can understand you. Remember, I am a kid, and I don't always understand grown-up words. Never promise me you will keep what I tell you a secret. Don't tell people who don't need to know. I need to trust you. You need to understand that it might be hard for me to talk about the abuse. Someone might have told me not to tell, or threatened to hurt me or my family if I do tell. I might feel embarrassed or think what happened was my fault. Make sure to tell me that you still care about me. Reassure me that what I tell you doesn't change how you feel about me. I might be testing you to see if I can trust you. I may have tried to tell others, but changed my mind. Don't act shocked about what I say. It could make me feel bad. Tell me that it took a lot of courage to tell what happened, and it was the right thing to do. If you are sad, tell me that it is because you care about me and don't want to see me hurt. Tell me you will be okay. I worry about you too. Tell me what is going to happen next. Don't ignore me just because I'm a kid. If I have questions, don't make up answers. Tell me that you don't know, but you will try to find out. It's okay not to always know the answer. I chose to tell you my biggest secret. I am trusting you to help me.
Okay. Children do entrust us with some of their biggest secrets, and we do need to treat them with respect and care and concern. So I thought that was a great way to talk about how you can respond should a child disclose abuse to you. Okay, let's go on. I have a white screen down here, so no comments. And let's talk about the bullying issue. When we hear about violence in schools, we hear about bullying. And certainly, bullying takes place in schools. It also takes place in families, in neighborhoods, takes place among children, adolescents, and adults in the workplace. So I think this is an issue that we're hearing a lot about, and I want to make some clarification points here. Okay, when we are talking about bullying, we are talking about, again, four different types of bullying. First, there are those open attacks of physical violence: hitting, kicking, pushing, punching. When we are talking about physical bullying, very often there are individuals who say, you know, that's an assault. And it can certainly be treated as an assault. I think sometimes the term bullying kind of waters it down a little bit. But I do think that there are legal repercussions to physical violence that can be pursued as in an assault. There is also verbal bullying, and name-calling, taunting, threatening, yelling, those mean words. Again, a verbal assault may not leave the physical injuries that we see with the physical assaults or the physical bullying, but can be extremely painful to endure. There's also social bullying, and in some circles that's called relational bullying. This is the bullying that's characterized by the manipulation of relationships. It can be relationships among peers, among classmates, amongst friends. The kind of what we call the mean girl phenomenon, but it also happens with guys. There is the spreading of rumors, of gossiping, isolating one of the individuals from the group, excluding them from social events, being cast out of the group. So we've talked about physical, verbal, social bullying, and we also need to talk about cyberbullying. In this day and age of media violence, and you're all making comments about it, there is a lot that we need to consider with cyberbullying. I would like to show you just a quick video clip before we go on. So could we have the public service announcement kitchen?
Megan. Hey, Jessica. Megan, you're a tramp. Brian Fitch told me you guys made out. Everybody knows. He said your breath smells like garbage, and he almost puked. He says you're the most desperate girl he knows, besides your mom. How many boyfriends does she have anyway? Lots? Your makeup makes you look like a clown.
Okay. Can you see that scenario playing out face to face? Probably not. But certainly those are the kind of conversations that we see in cyberbullying. This is referred to as electronic aggression. Typically using our communication technology to torment another. And this is a little bit different than the other three types of bullying that we addressed because it's so highly accessible by all. It can be perpetrated at any time, in any place. These messages get spread very quickly. And there can be some relative anonymity because it spreads so quickly, it's hard to find out sometimes where it started. And certainly this is the kind of bullying that because there is that anonymity that, you know, I'm doing it here on whatever screen I'm on and I don't have to see you face to face, I can say a lot more than I might say to you face to face and much more hurtful. Very often youth are very reluctant to report electronic aggression because they fear that their parents will take away their communication technology, their iPads, their phones, their computers, whatever it is that they're working on. They're afraid that that would be the response rather than dealing with the aggression itself. And then this brings up the whole issue again, just like we had on the playground fight, of the bystanders and the witnesses. Those who are not involved in that first communication, by spreading it, by passing it along, by making comments, broaden the circle of offenders, and where the bystanders or these witnesses could be standing up for the target, they're actually joining in. And so certainly much more difficult to deal with. When we talk about bullying, I hope that you will all remember that when we are addressing this, we're looking at three conditions that need to be met for it to be considered a bullying event, or to be called bullying, because bullying is not just an event. Okay, the three conditions that we need to consider are, the first, the negative behaviors toward the target student are intentional and usually unprovoked. Okay, now, and I did say student because in this class we're talking about public education, but it could be the target of any age. Okay, so the negative behavior toward that target is intentional. And it really doesn't matter whether it's provoked or unprovoked. It's that intentional targeting of that negative behavior. The second condition is that bullying behaviors are repeated over time. This is not the once or twice incident. This is over time. And then the third condition is there is an imbalance of power or perceived inequity between the perpetrator and the target. Okay, so these are not two individuals of the same status having an argument. This is where one individual, whether real or perceived, has more power and is targeting the other. And you do notice, I hope, that in my language, I'm using perpetrator as another name for the bully. I'm using target for the bullied. And I really tend to avoid the term victim, because victim brings up that mentality that they can't do anything, that they are powerless. And we want to certainly move away from the victim terminology. So those three conditions, it's intentional, it's repeated over time, and there is an imbalance of power. Certainly another way that I have often heard bullying described at are ABCD. So this will reinforce the three conditions, but it's another way to look at it. A is it's aggressive, or as I said earlier, it's an assault. B, the balance of power is absent. That's that imbalance. C is it is consistent or repeated over time. And then D, it is deliberate. It is intentional. Okay, so we can do the three conditions or we can do the ABCDs. I don't care which one you want. But remember, that's what we're talking about with bullying. Oftentimes, because bullying, we're talking about it so often, we use that term probably more than we should for conditions that are not really bullying. We all know of individuals who are rude, right? Rude individuals are inadvertently saying or doing something that hurts someone else. So there is not the intent there. We also know mean individuals, or mean kids, or mean adults. And that their behavior may be purposeful, but it's usually targeted once or twice. There's not that repetition over time. So I just want you to keep that in mind. I happened to be at a school dinner a few months ago, and I was sitting listening to a mother talk to her two siblings who appeared to be about the same age, and they were arguing over the last piece of pizza. And the mother said to the older child, "Don't bully your sister into getting that next piece of pizza." And I thought, okay, I don't know all of the conditions there. If that was a one-time thing, that wouldn't be a bully. If there was a balance of power in that family, that would not be bullying. So I think we tend to overuse the term sometimes. But we need to know what to do. With the bully, we need to take them aside and say, this behavior stops now. We need to identify the behavior for the bully, tell them it will not be tolerated, and then we need to keep watching that, and we need to call them on those behaviors. Very often, we ignore things going on in the hallways, in classrooms, just don't want to deal with one more thing. The more we do that, the more the bully gains power. With the bullied, the target student, we need to let them know that the behavior should not continue, that if it does, they need to keep reporting it. We encourage the bully to talk about the behavior, to possibly, you know, build up more friends. Sometimes it's more difficult for a bully to engage in that behavior when the intended target has some close friends around, some folks who will stand up for them. But we certainly want to reinforce safety measures for the bullied. And then with the bystanders, or what we're now calling upstanders, the audience, we need to talk with them and say, look, when you see these things happening, you need to report. You need to tell the bully to stop. You need to stand up for the bullied. You need to tell adults to get help. So we really need to reinforce that, because it's what the bystanders do or don't do that gives the bully power or takes power away. Let's take a look at a quick video clip, another short one on bullying prevention lockers. Let's see that.
Don't look at me.
Your hair's a bit frizzy today.
Aww.
You should pick that up.
Oh, you're such a dork.
Loser.
Here, let me help you with that.
Oops. Every day, kids witness bullying.
Oh, look. Your crush is looking at you.
Poor you.
They want to help, but don't know how.
See, no one here's going to help you, because no one...
Teach your kids how to be more than a bystander. Visit stopbullying.gov.
Real quick little video clip targeted toward parents to encourage them to talk with their children. So again, if you're having parent conversations about bullying in your school, in your organization, be sure to bring that in as well. Okay, and then in just the last couple minutes before break, I do want to briefly touch on the issue of sexual harassment. We're going to talk about this a little bit after our break, but I want to remind you just a little bit about sexual harassment. It is an act of violence. Very often, it is an example of sexual bullying. Sexual harassment includes unwelcome sexual advances that affect a student's well-being. These can be jokes, it can be graffiti, bra snapping, pulling down their pants. It can be an attempted sexual assault. It can be pictures, etc. Very often, these behaviors do occur in public and are frequently witnessed. Again, bystanders, upstanders are not saying anything, not doing anything, so we really need to change the cultures. I noticed, I think it was Douglas had a comment up on the screen about it being, violence is just a social norm, and we've talked about child abuse, we've talked about bullying, we're now talking about sexual harassment, and we have individuals who are seeing this occur out in public and not doing anything. So we really need to change our social norms and say it's okay to talk about those things, and when you see those things happening, you know, tell that individual, hey, stop, that's not okay. You know, support the target in getting additional help. Very often we as adults, even amongst teen groups, tend to downplay sexual harassment. We say, oh, it's just flirting behaviors. Well, we need to remember that flirting makes us feel good, it's welcomed, typically it's going back and forth both ways, whereas sexual harassment is unwelcome. It hurts, it's only a one-way comment. We need to teach our students the difference between flirting and hurting, and that they need to stand up when anyone engages in any behavior that hurts them either physically, mentally, or emotionally. And certainly there are legal responsibilities here as well. Teachers and schools have legal responsibility to report any type of report of sexual harassment or any observation of sexual harassment. And in every one of your schools or organizations, you should have policies around prevention, instruction around sexual harassment, around intervention, reporting, and you need to know those policies and implement them. So that's going to bring us to the end of our first hour. I've talked very quickly about some very large issues of violence. I appreciate all of your comments and how you really are kind of looking at the interplay between community and families and schools, the impact of social norms, of media on how we view violence. And we just need to continue to work at that. We need to keep sending prevention messages to students, and we need to intervene when we observe, when we have suspicion of, or when we get reports of any of these types of violence. Okay, so let's take a 10-minute break, and we will come back and continue our discussion of violence in schools and what we can do about that. So let's take a 10-minute break. I will see you soon. Get up, move around, get a snack. See you in 10.
You are watching DHTV, the television program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
My name is Grant Wagner, and I'm a teacher here at Menachie High School, and I've had the good fortune to be involved with the Young Scholar Program through CSU Dominguez Hills for over 10 years. We have encouraged our kids to take on this opportunity, this challenge, for various reasons. One, it allows our students, for a very nominal fee, $3.50 for a college class, to experience what college is going to be like.
What I like best about the program is how it fits to your schedule. Like, you can watch the lectures whenever is convenient for you, and it's really easy to talk to the professors.
And these students, whether they pass or fail, are learning some valuable lessons about what it's like to be a college student.
The thing I like best about the courses I take through the Young Scholar Program is the difficulty of the courses. A lot of people think that they're easy to take, but they're actually pretty difficult, and they challenge you, and they really make you think, and that's how college is going to be, so it really prepares you for college.
This program is really an incentive for students that have a 3.0 grade point average and are ready to face the rigors of the college environment.
I encourage students to enroll in the Young Scholar Program at California State University of Dominguez Hills because of the advantages they have when they leave high school. They have college credit and an incredible value.
What Dominguez Hills is to me is actually just a great learning environment for me because of the Young Scholars Program. It's really helped me just know a lot more about marine biology and astronomy and currently just like logic and just the individual in society. It's just all great classes, and it's really nice to like use something that you don't really learn in high school, get outside information from Dominguez Hills, and just apply that to the outside world.
This series of classes allows our high school students, it empowers them to solve their own problems. And the Young Scholar Program allows the kids to do that.
Hi, my name is Mara Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Hi, my name is Aaron Reyes. I'm part of the Health Insurance Education Project here at Cal State Dominguez Hills. Through the Health Science Department and Cover California, I'm here to educate students, their families, and the community about what Covered California is and what it means for your families. Covered California enables millions of uninsured Americans to have the health coverage that so many desperately need. The Affordable Care Act offers new protections to individuals, including no denial of coverage for those with pre-existing conditions like diabetes and asthma, no co-pays for preventative care visits, no annual or lifetime limits on services, access to mental health services, and young adults under 26 can stay under the parents' health plans. Starting January 1st, 2014, federal law requires that all eligible individuals have health insurance. The open enrollment period begins the 1st of October and continues until March 31st, 2014. If you are currently insured, either through your job, through your parents, or through Medi-Cal, then there's nothing that you need to do. But if you are like many who need insurance, then Covered California will help you get affordable insurance.
This is good. I think they rose to the occasion.
Dude, love. Brother, love. That Mandarin sauce is ridiculous. The heat was fantastic. I enjoyed the flavors.
Our champion is the Literals.
Enrich your life. Increase your earning potential. Cal State Dominguez Hills offers a master's degree in humanities. With a focus on the cities of the world, this master's degree can be earned in as little as 5 semesters. Evening classes are available for your convenience. Why wait? Call 310-243-3636. That's 310-243-3636.
My name is Alberto Mieriterán. I'm the Senior Vice President and General Manager of the Univision Los Angeles television stations. We have a beautiful partnership with Cal State Dominguez Hills and the Cal State University School System, in which we have partnered up to do what I consider, I'm a little biased, the best educational fair in the country. Fifth year of working with Cal State Dominguez Hills, and it's been absolutely a wonderful success story in the fact that every year it grows, it gets better. It's a huge resource to the community, to both the surrounding community in Carson and to the Latino community.
So it's really, really exciting that we are trying to increase like the amount of students that go into college.
My name is Zanea Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
You're watching DHTV, the broadcast program service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Welcome back. We are here this morning talking about violence in schools. This is Cal State Dominguez Hills Health in Public Education course. And during our first hour, we talked a great deal about the impact of violence on children in schools, what that does to their health and well-being, as well as their academic achievement. We addressed the issues of child abuse. We talked about bullying. And we started a little bit of a discussion on sexual harassment. Certainly those are examples or themes of violence in schools. And I'd like to continue that discussion during our second hour. And I am very pleased to have with us a guest and a longtime colleague in the field of violence prevention. This is Giovanna Martinez, and I'm going to let her introduce herself, share a little bit about who she is, where she works, and what she does, and then we're going to continue that violence discussion because of her experiences in schools. So welcome.
Thank you for having me. Good morning.
Good morning. All right. Why don't you tell my students, who are many of them working preschool through high school, and working with children in schools, just a little bit about yourself and about WomanShelter and about what you do.
Well, I'm the Youth Services Coordinator for WomanShelter of Long Beach, and I run the youth programs for youth ages 7 to 24. We go into high schools and middle schools, and we talk about teen dating violence, the effects of domestic violence in your home, and we also have supportive services in our agency when it comes to domestic violence and being a victim of abuse in your home.
Very good. Well, mm-hmm. I have had the pleasure of working with Giovanna in the Long Beach Unified School District for many years.
Yes.
We won't say how many.
I know.
And in the work that the WomanShelter of Long Beach does, particularly with our schools, middle and high school, as I shared in that first hour, are the need to teach students about these types of violence.
Yes.
What these behaviors are and that they are not the norm.
Yes.
I think many of my students have commented all morning that, you know, the violence that's seen in the, portrayed in the media just really kind of normalizes it. And so we want to teach students that it's not normal. It's not the status quo. It's not a healthy relationship. Mm-hmm. And then we want to certainly provide them with the skills to know what to do if they find themselves in that kind of situation. So in regards to teen dating violence, I'm finding that there is a lot of commonality between teen dating violence and child abuse and bullying and sexual harassment. Would you agree?
I would definitely agree. I think when we talk about abuse, there are a lot of intersections and we come together in many ways. I think when we talk about teen dating violence, a lot of our youth who are going through this or in relationships like this probably have come from homes where there was already domestic violence or child abuse or some sexual assault. Statistic-wise, if you have grown up in a home where there was domestic violence, you're at least 85% more likely to be in an abusive relationship or an abuser yourself. So we definitely see where everything kind of connects. I think as an advocate and working in in our community, and as a teacher as well, it's really important to have resources from every area because you never know. And I think it makes you a better advocate for our youth when we talk about that.
Okay, so let's define, what is it we're talking about when we're talking about teen dating violence, or some circles, I think they call it relationship violence. What is it exactly that we're talking about?
Well, for us at Women's Shelter, we definitely call it teen dating violence. We give it its own group. We have its own services. It's violence in relationships and youth between the ages of 14 to 19.
Okay.
Sometimes we've seen it as young as 12. Mm. We've definitely seen it as young as 12. But the common age that we see at Women's Shelter is about that age range. Mm. It mirrors domestic violence relationships, mm-hmm. adult relationships, but there are many different aspects of it that mm-hmm. make it a little bit different. Where when it comes to teens being in a relationship, it's more of a whirlwind. It mm-hmm. happens really fast, mm-hmm. you know. Our teenage relationships where by Monday you think this person is cute and by Friday you're so in love with them.
Right.
I think that makes it a little more dangerous when it comes to abusive relationships, because just as soon as you get into this relationship, the violence could start. And makes it a little more violent. Also, being in the same school gives our youth a more fear of entrapment by the abuser. Technology plays a huge thing, you know, huge thing into it. So it definitely mirrors a lot of the signs that we see of domestic violence, but it has its own entities and warning signs that we need to pay attention to.
Okay. All right. So I know that I have a few students out there who are working in middle and high schoolers. So I want you to really listen carefully and think about your students as Giovanna shares some of this, because it may be something that you can weave into your instruction and certainly into your referral for support services. So when we talk about teen dating violence, what types of behaviors are we talking about?
We're definitely talking about, I know when we talk about just teen dating violence and domestic violence in general, we think, well, if we're not seeing any physical signs, mm-hmm. it might not be abuse. Mm. And relationship violence isn't always about the physical signs. There are emotional signs, mental signs. If you get to know your students and the youth that you work for, and you're starting to see them withdraw, mm-hmm. decline in their grades, if you're starting to see them kind of have anxiety because they can't text their partner right away or answer that call right away. If you start to see them isolate themselves, where they used to be very active and attending clubs and now they're just really about this person, those are huge red flags that we see when we work with youth. Also, if you start to see them kind of have a fear and just an anxiety when they're going through the cycle of violence with their partner, if they're making excuses for their partner. We talk to the youth about having hickeys,
mm-hmm.
or the youth are calling them hater marks now, you know, what that means.
They're calling them what?
Hater marks.
Hater marks, yes, okay.
Yes.
New term.
I know, new term, so write that down. But it really is, it may not mean that the relationship is abusive, but if you're constantly seeing marks on that youth's neck when their abusive partner is not around, it's a sign of possession and things like that. So
kind of a little tag that says, this one's mine.
Exactly.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. What... So when we talk about teen dating violence with students, what is it that they need to know?
I think when we talk about teen dating violence with students, we definitely, when we go into the schools, we teach them warning signs, kind of what we discussed. We also talk about extreme jealousy, that jealousy does not equal love. A lot of the youth have this belief that because their partner is jealous in this matter, it means they really care about them. So we have those conversations. We definitely want them to know that there is help.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of our youth don't think that there's someone out there to help them, mm-hmm. or that they're not going to be taken seriously because they're so young, or maybe they're not allowed to date yet, you know, so to reach out that there's help. We also want them to be able to feel safe and comfortable. Mm-hmm. We always like to tell them, you know, your teacher is aware of who we are.
Mm-hmm.
This could be your first, you know, person you go to, you know. Obviously, they have the resources, and to kind of find a safety map for themselves.
Well, I know so many teens think, well, you know, this partner, I mean, he or she always wants to know where I am. They just love me so much. Mm-hmm. They want to know what I'm doing, who I'm with, where I am, and when I'm going to be back. I mean, I think teens think that that's an incredibly wonderful thing.
Oh, yeah.
But you're saying that that's really a sign of possession.
Yes.
and possessiveness.
Yes, and when it goes into that jealousy aspect, we also talk about the contrast of what a healthy and unhealthy relationship is. You have the right to be with your friends mm-hmm. and to have access to your own passwords. A lot of our teens are giving up their Facebook passwords, their Instagram passwords, things, their social media. They're giving their partner complete access to that, you know, and they don't realize that they have the right to have their private social media aspects. They have the right to have their own friends. If they can't call that person at that time, it's okay. Mm-hmm. And we teach them to kind of red flag that. If mm-hmm. this person is getting really upset because you didn't call them, what does that say? Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. if they're trying to change the way you dress, mm-hmm. you know, or act, you know, I don't want you wearing that tank top anymore around your mm-hmm. friends, or if it's a girl who's been abusive to a guy, you know, why don't you wear the hat that I bought you that everybody knows I bought you, mm-hmm. you know, kind of that possessiveness and the almost obsession.
And I'm guessing that this is a one-way type of behavior, where one of the partners has all the passwords,
yes.
but not the other.
Not the other.
So yeah. there's that imbalance
yes.
of power.
Yes.
So a little bit about what we talk about with bullying
yes.
is whether it's real or perceived,
yes.
there's that imbalance of power.
Yeah.
And another issue that I've often heard discussed when talking about domestic violence and teen dating violence is the whole issue of power and control. So what do we tell students about power and control?
Well, we really talk to them and say, you know, when you're in a relationship, it's about equality. And if you are in an unhealthy relationship, the abuser is always trying to gain power and control over you. And what are the small things that you can notice that they're doing? The manipulation, the mind games. If they're constantly making fun of you in front of your friends, mm-hmm. but you can't do the same, you know, you can't make fun of them or say something or stand up because it'll blow up on you. Mm-hmm. What does that say about that? Mm-hmm. Also, we talk about the fact that when it's an unhealthy balance of power, you can't make those decisions. Mm-hmm. Have there been times where you're telling your partner, hey, I'm going to go hang out with my family. Mm-hmm. And then now the abuser's like, I thought it was about us. Why are you going to go hang out with your friends? It's only about you and I. Mm-hmm. And so kind of twisting it and playing those mind games. So we definitely go over the warning signs and the small little things that we can see that you start seeing the separation of power. If you feel like you're afraid to break mm-hmm. up with your partner. Mm-hmm. I always give them the example that, you know, I adore my partner, but if there was a moment that I didn't feel that this was right, I'm not afraid to say, you know, nice knowing you and uh-huh. I'll see you later. You know, but for a youth, if you have that fear to say no or to break up with them, that's a huge warning mm-hmm. sign.
Right. Mm-hmm. The other thing I've heard you talk with students about is this cycle of violence. Because some of our middle and high schoolers will say, well, you know, once he kind of blows off some steam, then it's okay. Mm-hmm. Can we elaborate a little bit? What is that cycle of violence that we see in relationships?
I usually like to tell the youth it's like our blueprint, our map of how this unhealthy relationship is going to go. Mm-hmm. It's marked by three stages, typically the honeymoon, or mm-hmm. I like to say the delicious stage, because it's that happy stage. Mm-hmm. Everything is great. You know, you change your Facebook status to we're in a relationship. Mm-hmm. It's that really great stage, you know. And then in a healthy relationship, that grows. You know, you build intimacy, you become friends. It grows into better things. In an unhealthy relationship, that kind of takes a right turn into the what we call the tension phase, mm-hmm. where you're starting to see those, you know, you're starting to see those examples of jealousy. You're starting to see that person, you know, question where you are, or maybe blow up on someone. Mm-hmm. I usually tell them, pay attention how they treat their parents or their mm-hmm. siblings, mm-hmm. you know, because these are the people who are closest to them. If they're blowing up on their siblings or beating up their siblings constantly, that might be a little, mm-hmm. you know, red flag for right. you. Also, you'll start to see, like, are they asking you for your password? You'll start seeing that building, and we talk about how that feels, that anxiety, mm-hmm. if you're not calling them, that anxiety if you don't show up or if you don't reply to a message. And then how it doesn't matter how you behave, because a lot of our youth equate it with them not being a good partner, you know? And sometimes the abuser is giving them those messages. You're not a good partner, or you don't love me enough because you didn't do this, or you're so lucky to have me. So they're starting to self-blame. And before you know it, there's an explosion phase. You know, that big fight. And it's not necessarily violent right away. Mm-hmm. It could be some, you know, them just getting really upset and cussing at you and blowing up on you mm-hmm. in that way. And then it's back to that honeymoon or that delicious, I'm sorry, please forgive me. It's about you and I will never do this again. I don't understand why this happened, right. You know?
Yeah, I've heard kids say, well, you know, I just felt like I was kind of walking on eggshells. Mm-hmm. And then, you know, we have the big fight, and then it's wonderful.
It's a bit.
Because
mm-hmm.
if I can just get over the big fight. But then they start to see this mm-hmm. happen again and mm-hmm. again. And so it really mm-hmm. does become kind of that cycle.
Yes.
And I think that's where, when students know what all of this yeah. is, they're able to maybe reflect a little bit more and say, whoa, maybe something's happening that I don't want to continue in. So what do we do? How do we help a teen get out of a relationship when there is that threat of violence, whether it's physical, verbal, emotional, the whole cyber
thing. Bullying.
Yeah,
when you're in that cycle of violence, you're definitely fueled. It's fueled by control mm-hmm. and how much control that abuser has. A lot of times when we want to help a youth, not only as peers, as teachers, as parents, we see that violence happen, that explosion mm-hmm. happen, and we're like, get out. Mm-hmm. Let's go. Run. You know, right. You can't be in with this person. I need to protect you now. You know, we need to do something. I'm going to call the police. What they don't realize is that honeymoon stage is right around the corner. And all that, I'm sorry, this is never going to happen again, is kind of where it goes next. And that's really hard, not only for a counselor to sit and talk to a youth and right. say, you deserve better, when the abuser is saying, I love you, I'll never do this again.
Right.
You know, I usually tell them that they'll probably come to you during the tension phase when they're starting to recognize. Because as soon as that honeymoon phase is over, there'll be that reality that hits and say, hey, is this happening? You know, mm-hmm. what is going on? Mm-hmm. They're extremely jealous. They'll reach out. Mm-hmm. Unfortunately, with this cycle of violence, the honeymoon stage eventually disappears. Oh. Every time it goes around, it increases. The violence increases.
Okay, so the tension and the explosion phase take up more
yes.
of that cycle and
yes.
less on the honeymoon.
And the honeymoon eventually disappears. And that's a very dangerous part to intervene and get help. Mm-hmm. What I usually say is let them come to you. Statistically, mm-hmm. it takes a victim about 7 times before they actually leave. And we're talking about adults and youth, you know.
Right.
And I think with our youth, with their mentality of, I can fix it all and I'm invincible, I think those statistics are a little bit higher, you know. So as a supportive person, I'm always the one who says, you know, I'm here mm-hmm. regardless. I've worked with many of our youth in the Long Beach Unified School District, mm-hmm. and sometimes it's taken me 3 years before they access some help.
Right.
But it's about always letting them know that I'll be here and the door's open and we have these services. I think most of the cases where youth have come forward have been the classrooms that have had brochures displayed mm-hmm. that have invited people to come in and speak about this conversation. Teachers who've made the classroom a lot more relevant for their youth in that moment. Mm-hmm. I'm always, every time I go to presentations, stocking up those brochures for them again.
Right.
Because it's a little small sign saying, I know that there's help for you.
Right. You know? Right. Well, and sometimes it is hearing the message from different individuals.
Yes.
Seeing it in print a couple of times. What about working with parents? Does WomanShelter, do you ever talk with parents? We've talked a lot about that in our first hour, is the need to connect with parents as well. What kinds of things do you tell parents about teen dating violence?
You know, usually when they come to me, it's because the violence has happened and there's a report and the parents are aware. There's a small cases that the parents aren't aware. You know, and when it comes to working and counseling and mental health, we have to respect the privacy of our client.
Sure.
But I'm always talking to the client and working on ways how we can start a conversation. you know? And how can we talk to your parent or mediate something where, you know, we discuss what's going on? The reality is when this has happened, the parents instantly go into protective mode and I can't believe this is happening. I don't want you to see them again. And they don't know that at that point, they're probably isolating their youth even more, right. You know, because the manipulation and the control is there. So the conversation I have with the parents who are going through this is one of like, you need to be supportive. Mm-hmm. I understand right now they may say that they love them and they still want to be with them. But if you blow up, you're only reiterating the messages that the abuser is saying. Mm-hmm. Your parents don't understand us. They're going to yell at you. They're going to take your phone away. It's about being supportive, and we've got to encourage our youth to make those decisions, mm-hmm. you know, and accessing, you know, help. I get a lot of parents calling me, and they can't believe that this has happened. Mm-hmm. A lot of youth who grow up in healthy homes and are dating mm-hmm. abusive partners who grew up in unhealthy homes. Mm-hmm. Or I get a lot of parents who call me and say, you know, this was an example that I gave my youth. Mm-hmm. Their father or their mother treated us the same way, and now I feel extreme, you know, guilty and bad, and what do I do? So it's really about realizing that the abuser needs to take accountability for their actions, and we can sit there and put blame anywhere, but it's about helping our youth. Right. I think there should be more awareness to parents and mm-hmm. conferences and things like that. I mean, I know when we talk about having them come to the school and be involved, it's always really hard. Mm-hmm. You know, we're so busy. It's really hard to get our parents involved a lot of times, but to be able to have that space where we have a greater conversation, you know, about it.
I do agree. I think parents don't want to believe that their babies, even though they're in high school, mm-hmm. it could, you know, be in a relationship mm-hmm. that's, you know, experiencing this, whether they had a similar relationship mm-hmm. or not. Mm-hmm. And sometimes mm-hmm. they may not be as involved in mm-hmm. that teen's life, and so it does come as a surprise. Mm-hmm. But I do think it's hard messages for mm-hmm. them to hear. I think it's hard for teachers. Mm-hmm. Because I think teachers go into that protective mode as
Definitely.
Well, and then they feel guilty if
Definitely.
they can't get that teen out mm-hmm. of the relationship. Mm-hmm. And it's very frustrating.
It is.
Because you see them go back and back and back. And we just have to keep reinforcing,
Exactly.
be there for that teen, right?
Yeah, and I think, like I said, the conversations we've had with the teachers are the ones that have said, hey, I'm here. I've mm-hmm. had teachers where they've taught the teen in ninth grade, and in their senior year, they're coming back to talk mm-hmm. to them because mm-hmm. they remembered that was the teacher who said, you know, I know where there's help if you ever need anything, you know. So it's about being aware, I mm-hmm. think, and like you said, just being there for them.
Right. I'm going to go to a couple of our comments, and let's see. And then for those of you who haven't put in a comment, would like to, if you have a question for Giovanna, please get that in right away, because we just have a little bit of time left in our broadcast. But I do want to acknowledge those that that have put in comments. So Erica, and some of these may be directly related to teen dating violence, some just the violence issue itself. Erica asked one student the other day where he'd been. He hadn't seen him. He said, I'm at home because I don't like school. And when asked why not, he says, because kids are always messing with me. So staying at home certainly affects learning. We talked about the increased absenteeism.
Yeah.
And then if the violence is going on, you know, they certainly can't focus. Thanks for that comment, Erica. I think that's really important, is that when there is violence at school, kids want to retreat at home, which is not what we want. We want to deal with the violence and stop it at school, but we also want to make sure that we continue that learning process. And I'm wondering if sometimes that doesn't happen with our teens who are in violent relationships. I wonder if they avoid school because we notice and we talk about mm-hmm. it, or they avoid school because the
abuser's
there.
Yeah.
So are you seeing that some of our teens in these relationships are also having difficulty at school?
I'm definitely seeing that as a big warning sign. Mm-hmm. If, like I said, you've had a teen that you've worked with, a youth that you've worked with, and you see that drop academically, mm-hmm. you see them not attending school, their sports, and they're kind of isolating themselves from what they were or who they were, that's a huge warning sign. And it could lead to ditching, absentees. The abuser is probably saying, let's not go to school. You know, why do you want to go to your first period class where that boy or that girl is looking at you or talking to you? Come over here, you know. So we definitely see that. Also, once if you're in the same school and the abuse has come to light and there's some intervention, a lot of the youth are afraid to go back because they're not sure if the school is going to protect them. And they don't realize that if you take a restraining order to school, the school will protect you. It's, you know, it's a court order.
Absolutely.
You know,
let's talk just a little bit about restraining orders because, I mean, we've all heard about them on TV shows.
Yes.
So it is possible for a teen to get a restraining order. So tell us about what that is and what the process is for that student.
Well, a restraining order is a court-ordered document. It's not bulletproof. It's just a piece of paper. And that keeps your abuser away from you 50 to 100 feet, depending on what they set. You can get a restraining order. You can be a youth under the up to the age of 12, 12 and over, to get a restraining order without your parents' permission. You can go to the court and you can say, I have fear that my partner is hurting me. I think I need a restraining order. Of course, the more evidence you have, the better it is. So text messages, printouts of instant messages, comments, anything digital that they have left that you can print out and take of threats is a great way. Pictures of bruises, a witness, anyone that will kind of corroborate your story of violence or abuse, and to show to the court that you feel fear that this person is going to do something to you. Once that has happened, we recommend to the student to go and take the restraining order to the administrator, tell everybody. Unfortunately, it could be embarrassing, but if the school doesn't know, they can't protect you. So we talk about being a little more vocal about it. Tell the administrator, take a picture, say this is the person who is hurting me or I'm afraid of, and they can't, you know. Many times when we work with restraining orders in schools in Long Beach, they will move the students' classes because they want to keep that person safe if they're sharing a class. So the school will protect you, and I don't think they understand that they can go and show the restraining order.
Well, it's a little scary for a teenager to go to the court.
It is.
Are there court advocates or supportive adults that
will work with them? Yes, there is definitely supportive adults and court advocates at Women's Shelter of Long Beach. Okay. There's myself and my staff that we've accompanied many teens to court to get the restraining orders. We also have an advocate in the Long Beach Superior Court where they're stationed there to help our victims get a restraining order. So when a youth goes, they know to ask for that person, and there'll be that guidance and that help.
So this is another one of those services that teens 12 and older can get without parent notification, permission, whatever. So another thing to think about there. I think that did come up when we talked about mental health services as well, and substance abuse services. Okay, let's just go back and look at a couple more comments. Mike states that students should be able to step up and put a stop on the violence or bullying. And yes, they should. But very often they don't. There is that pressure to keep quiet, to not share, to ignore, because often they're afraid that the violence might be directed toward them. And I think that's maybe true with teen dating violence situations as well.
Yes, I think that's also something we can say caution. We know we want our students to step up and take action. I think as a greater component, we definitely have to educate our students, but we have to educate them on what the right way is to take action.
Because
we'll say a lot of students want to act and maybe want to, you know, stop violence with violence.
And
that's not safe. And we talk about that with abusive relationships. When we go into the schools, a lot of the youth will have, you know, say, well, I would protect them, or I would go beat up that abuser. And we say, you know, that's great that you want to help, but that might not be the best way, because after you've dealt with the abuser and you leave, now you're leaving the victim alone, and that abuser is going to come back and say, why did you tell someone and hurt the victim again?
Well, and again, the whole issue of bystanders or upstanders is that we're there to support the target. And really start to change some of the social norms. Sonia has a comment, and we just lost part of it, that... She's asking, why aren't teachers allowed to intervene other than a stop that or go to the principal's office? Okay, I'm going to read the rest of this to see what that means. There was an incident where a parent was coming in to pick up a child, and then they were physically abusing them in front of the school staff. I think what I'm reading into this. How is that allowed? Well, I don't know that. You want to do the verbal, you know, you need to stop, that's not allowed. I don't think it's safe to get into the middle of any type of violent situation. And if that is taking place on a school campus, certainly calling the school security officer. And if not the school security officer, that would, you know, you could certainly call the local law enforcement office and just explain again what you've seen and, you know, what's happening, and be safe yourself. So I think that often is a time that, you know, we want to get in there and break it up, but we might not be able to.
And I think that also comes into play when we talk about abuse and we go into the classrooms and a lot of the kids disclose. We definitely have the conversation with the teachers about having them go to their counselor, and maybe there might be a moment where you need to have a report, a mandated report done.
Right.
Definitely keep yourself safe in a situation that you are witnessing. Right. If this is happening, I guess you're right, you know, go to the security of your school, if the law enforcement needs to be involved, but always, you know, at least say something, you know, and don't let that situation kind of go by.
Right. Okay. All right. A couple more questions. Alice is asking, how much of the problem is a student who is afraid to tell their parent that there is a problem? Is it because they anticipate a negative response from the parent or parents, or is it that I got myself into this, so I just need to deal with it? I mean, I do know that students are afraid.
Yes.
For many reasons to tell friends and family.
Yes.
And so I think that's part of the education that we do with students. I don't know how many times you've said to students, you need to tell somebody what's going on, right?
We usually, there was a study done a few years ago in New York. About 1,000 students were polled, and they said, if you were in an abusive relationship, who's the first person you would tell? 71% of those students would go to a peer first. Mm-hmm. Counselors and teachers were down at the bottom, and with parents. Parents was like the second biggest, I think. But a lot of times, the reasons why they don't go to their parents first is because they're afraid that maybe the abuse is happening at home. Mm-hmm. And so here we are going through this not only with ourselves. They might be abused themselves, or so they're afraid of that parent. That conversation can't be had there. What we do is we go in and we empower the peers. Mm-hmm. So I will tell our youth, if you're someone's friend, can you imagine how much more of an impact you have in their lives, and help them find the help. We talk to the youth as being the person that can help facilitate, you know, some services for their friend. A lot of times going to the parent is a big thing because they don't know how the parent's going to react. I said maybe they might not be allowed to date yet, culturally. You know, for me as a Latina, I couldn't really date till I was 15. You know, I may have had boyfriends before, but, you know, my parents didn't know. And what if those relationships were abusive? How do I tell my parents? Also, youth who are LGBTQ, lesbian, gay, bisexual, transgender, queer, if they are not out to the community, to their family, if this is not accepted, the fear of telling anyone will keep them quiet.
Well, because then they're not only disclosing
the
violent
yes.
relationship,
but now,
but their,
you know,
own
who they
sexuality.
Are.
Exactly. Yes. Okay, Tammy has a great, very simple question, and I think we probably have a couple of really simple statements that we can respond to. How do you talk to a child or even an adult who is in an abusive relationship?
You know, I think the best thing to say to a child, a youth, or an adult who's in an abusive relationship is, you deserve better. You know, this is not right and this is not healthy. A lot of times the abusers are already saying messages to them that we're not aware that we're kind of reiterating, or we victim blame a lot. Mm-hmm. Why are you with them? Or you're so dumb, or, you know, why don't you do something? Those are the questions that they're already asking themselves. So just to be supportive and say, you know, you deserve better and I'm here to help you and what can I do is really the best way to talk to someone.
I think it's back to some of those statements that we've said in several of the broadcasts. I care about you, I'm concerned. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. If you need anything, let me know.
Yes.
I think that's what we need to say to our students, Tammy. Okay, Adam also made a comment this morning. He had no idea about the 12-year-old student, the youth laws around accessing services. And those have been around
for a while.
Quite a while. I know that there are lots of folks who are real nervous about 12-year-olds getting any kind of medical, psychological, or social services at that age, without parent consent. And we certainly want to encourage them to include their family.
Yes, definitely.
But sometimes they're not able to. So.
Yeah, for many reasons, like abuse going on as well. There's a great website, californiayouthlaw.org. You can Google it, but I'm pretty sure that's the website. That's it. And it will tell you up to date the youth laws that they are. Also, restraining orders are free.
Yes.
They are free. So that's another thing you can tell a youth, you know.
I think, you know, Adam goes on to say, I can't imagine a sixth grader doing this on their own, but it's good to know.
Yes.
So I'm glad you learned that today, Adam. I hope all of you will remember that. And again, we don't want to force them out the door to do that on their own, but certainly they can. And it's always nice to know that there are folks around who can help them to do that if they need to.
Yes.
Okay. Do we have any more comments down on the scrolling? Let's see. I always want to recognize students who are actually up with us on Saturday morning. It looks like we've got them all. Okay, so we've talked about what teachers can do. We've talked about what students need to know and can do. We've talked about, you know, the messages we need to get to parents. So how about just in our last minute or so, we just identify, you know, what is the message that we want to get to our kids about violent relationships?
Definitely. I think when we are talking to our youth, and the message is that there is help out there and that you don't have to be silent, that there are people who are going to help you and there's services for you. There's a lot of fear when it comes to abuse in total, anything, bullying, child abuse, sexual abuse, any type of abuse. There is a lot of fear, and we need to realize that there is help out there, and you can access it.
Right. And I think, Women's Shelter of Long Beach is an amazing resource in our community, and actually Giovanna is going to stay with me for my next class, the Health 395, and we'll talk a little bit more about the community issues that Women's Shelter is involved in. And what I encourage all of you is to find those resources in your community if you are outside of the area that the Women's Shelter serves. And I know they serve more than Long Beach,
yes,
so
I do.
You can certainly access their website information. Okay, that brings us to the end of our broadcast for Health in Public Education. I want to remind all of you who are taking this class that we will not have class next week as it is spring break. So you can spend your Saturday morning doing something else rather than sitting there watching class. And we will come back on April 12th. And we will start the content area of growth, development, and sexual health, which we're just kind of weaving lots of the same content into. So we will see all of you in 2 weeks. And if you'd like to stay for our next broadcast, we'll be back in 10 minutes. And we'll talk about Women's Shelter in the Long Beach community. Here's wishing you health, peace, and happiness. Take care.